You have all been given words to join us in a time of praise and worship. So please join with us, with our praise team and jubilant voices as we begin singing Melodies from Heaven. Amen.
Lay down on me. Lay down on me. Like that, y'all.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns.
I can't hear you.
From heaven above with wings, some power and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Yeah.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns. From heaven above with wings, some power and love. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns. He reigns. He reigns. Forever and ever.
Opening prayer. Father, we come before you this morning declaring that we love you. Thank you that you have made a way to love known through only your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would reveal this great love to us today as we gather here to worship. Lead us by your Spirit, God. Lead us by your Spirit to praise you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the gift of this day and for the blessings you have poured upon us. We acknowledge that all good things come from you and only you, Father. And we are grateful for your faithfulness and your provision, Father. Amen. God. You are the author and the perfecter of our faith, yes, Father Lord. God. You save us and you sustain us, Father. Hallelujah. God. And so, God, we come before you today laying down our pride, our arrogance, and we confess our need for you, Father God. We ask your forgiveness for our sins, Father God. We lay our knees at your feet and worship you and you alone. Come, Holy Spirit, help us to see and worship, to trust and to live, starting right now, Father God. In the name of Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning and welcome to Holman United Methodist Church, where our vision is to grow. Oh, wait, sorry. Our vision is to be a place where bells are rung as we gather for dynamic worship, grow through inspired learning, and go into joyful service to live the gospel of Jesus Christ. And our mission is to fulfill the Great Commission by inviting people into discipleship with Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Safe and secure childcare is available for children 5 years and under. Please take your little ones to the nursery now through the rear entrance of the sanctuary. An usher or security guard will be with you.
And now for the call to worship. Come, Holy Spirit, the wind of God, the breath of life. Come, Holy Spirit, our advocate, our counselor. Come, Holy Spirit, teacher of wisdom, reminder of Christ. Come, Holy Spirit,
grantor of forgiveness, giver of peace.
Come, Holy Spirit, may we feel God breathing through our worship. May we receive the Holy Spirit in this place. Amen. Please be seated while the jubilant voices of Holman minister to us singing Trouble Don't Last Always by the Reverend Timothy White.
As
When you want him, but he's on time.
On time.
And every one of your burdens I know he'll be help you to bear. When storm clouds rise, they rise, he'll be there.
Be there.
Happy, you make me whole. You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you. You make me happy. You make me whole. You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you.
You make me happy.
You make me whole.
You make me whole.
You take the pain
you
away.
You take the pain away.
I'm so in love with you.
Sing it again, say.
You make me happy.
You make me whole.
You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you.
And everything about you.
Everything about you is right.
It covers all my wrongs.
It covers all my wrongs.
And everything about you.
Everything about you is right.
It covers all my wrongs.
It covers all my wrongs.
Your
life saved my life.
With you is where I belong. I belong to you, Lord. I belong to you, Lord. I belong to you, Lord.
You make me happy. You make me whole.
You take the pain
you
away.
You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you.
Sing it again, say.
You make me happy.
You make me whole.
You make me whole.
You take the pain
you
away.
You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you.
And everything about you.
Everything about you is right.
It covers all my wrongs.
It covers all my wrongs.
Everything about you.
Everything about you is right.
It covers all my wrongs.
It covers all my wrongs.
Your life saved my life.
With you is where I belong.
I belong to you, Lord. I belong to you, Lord. I belong to you, Lord.
You is where
I'm so in love with you. Can't make it without you.
Pentecost Sunday, the day we commemorate the Spirit falling like fire. And isn't it wonderful to have a little bit of fire up here in the house with these young people? Reminder, if you have a child 5 and younger that you'd like to take to child care, it's available across the way. You can take them out the back door and someone will direct you to child care. It's prayer time now. In our bulletins, we are actively praying for Dr. Earl Barner, Gwinnett Parker, Ilana Bailey Williams, James Bailey, Helen Harris, Lorraine Flanagan, Leonard White, Dr. Harold Jordan, Larry Turner, Dr. Barbara Lake, Brigitte Thompson, and the people of Los Angeles, Haiti, Gaza, and my former home city, Houston, Texas. Undoubtedly, this is not everyone that we should be praying for today. There are other people that are on your hearts. There are other concerns in your hearts. And we take a moment here to lift those up audibly now. Holy God, you are not hard of hearing. You reach into our hearts and into our very souls to know what is true in us. And these are our true concerns. These are people we truly care about and are lifting to you. Show up, God. Fall and show up as a healer. Fall and show up as a deliverer. Fall and show up as a peacemaker. Fall, Holy Spirit, in all these situations with all these beloved souls. fall fresh on them. And when we run out of our own words to pray, when we run out of the things that we know to say, we return to you, God, the words that Jesus taught his disciples when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Good morning. Please rise as you are able for the reading of Acts 2, 14 to 21 from the Common English Bible. Peter stood with the other 11 apostles. He raised his voice and declared, "Judeans and everyone living in Jerusalem, know this. Listen carefully to my words. These people aren't drunk as you suspect. After all, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. Rather, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young will see visions. Your elders will dream dreams. Even upon my servants, men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will cause wonders to occur in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and a cloud of smoke. The sun will be changed into darkness. The moon will be changed into blood before the great and spectacular day of the Lord comes, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
The Jubilant Voices will continue its ministry of music, singing Change by Tremaine Hawkins, featuring solos Debbie Bell. Following the selection, Pastor Victor Cyrus-Franklin will bring the good news in his Pentecost Day message, "A Change Is Gonna Come."
Washed away. have the honor of introducing our speaker, our preacher for the morning. I'm introducing him to very few because most of you know him. He is a Holmanite, having served here as an associate pastor early in his California tenure, hailing from Nashville, Tennessee, graduate of the mighty Tennessee State University. You know. But Reverend Victor Cyrus-Franklin is someone who's seen ministry as something that's not just about the pulpit. And in his sojourn that leads him on a direct path to this place, along the way, not only has he grown as a preacher, as a leader, as a humanitarian, but he's grown as a follower of Christ. Many of you probably have seen that he is featured, his project over at Inglewood First United Methodist Church is featured in the New York Times? Yeah. I defy this brother to take a bad picture. All his pictures look great, don't they? Just New York Times looking all, you know, yeah. Most of all, he is the proud husband of his amazing preacher wife. And his kids, who were babies here, are now running around. And one of them plays the drums, Ricardo. That's right. Just letting you know. Relief is coming.
That's right.
So if you don't mind today, would you give a Holman welcome to our guest preacher today, the very soon-to-be senior pastor of Holman United Methodist Church, Reverend Victor Cyrus-Franklin.
Amen, family.
Amen.
This is the day the Lord has made. We've come to rejoice. Rejoice.
Yes.
Been a while since I've been up here. Pastor Washington and all the leadership here at Holman United Methodist Church. It's an honor and a privilege to be invited to bring a word from the Lord from this pulpit, from this place and in this space. And on behalf of our sister congregation, First United Methodist Church of Inglewood, and my wife, Reverend Nima Cyrus-Franklin, Trey and Nani, who are all of 17 and 12 years old, Lord have mercy, Jesus. It's good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. The scripture has already been read in our hearing. And as we prepare for the preached word, let us go to the Lord in prayer. God, we thank you for the gift of your spirit and your presence and your guidance in our lives and bringing us here to this space for this hour of worship. We thank you for the gift of Pentecost Sunday and your Holy Spirit coming into the world and coming to our lives, the advocate, the presence, the comforter, leading us and guiding us along the way. We thank you for how your Holy Spirit has already led in worship through the singing of songs of praise this morning. We thank you for how your Spirit has already spoken in worship through the prayers that we have prayed, through the reading of the scriptures, through the music that has been played. We thank you for how your Spirit has already spoken through the greeters who welcomed us into this space and this place. Keep speaking through the preached word. Preach into and through me that your word may come forth, a word of power, a word of salvation, a word of liberation, a word of love, that we may grow closer to you, your will, and your way. This we pray in Jesus' name. And the people of God said, amen. Amen and amen. Amen, amen. Our topic for today on this Pentecost Sunday is a change is going to come. Somebody say a change is going to come. A change is going to come. One more time. Come on. Got to make sure we together. Got to make sure we together. Make sure we together. So as Pastor Washington said, in this graduation season, I always go back to my graduation from undergrad. As he said, I'm a proud graduate. I'm a Big Blue Tiger, Tennessee State University in Nashville, Tennessee. Big up to all schools are good. Higher education is good, but my HBCU folk, all right. Big up to all the HBCUs. And in so many ways, my undergraduate institution saved my life. When I started school, I was an undecided major. I didn't know what my major was going to be. I didn't know what my calling was, but I had a professor by the name of Dr. Helen Houston, who I know we say United Women in Faith, but she was a United Methodist woman, chair of the English department there, and I took a class on major Black American writers, and she introduced me to a novelist by the name of Octavia Butler. Right. Some of us know about Octavia Butler. One of her novels that she's most renowned for is Parable of the Sower. It's an award-winning novel published in 1993. The novel's set, it begins in the year of our Lord, 2024. And she gives an image of the future then from what she believes would be happening now. And it's from the perspective of a gifted teenage Black girl by the name of Lauren Olamina from Los Angeles, California. And through Lauren's diary entry, she tells the story of society's deterioration due to climate change, due to wealth inequality, due to racial injustice. The world is falling apart all around her, and she's trying to find faith in a world that seems to be collapsing everywhere she turns. She's the daughter of a Baptist minister, and she sees her father trying to hold their community together. They live in a gated community in a middle-class enclave. There's a wall separating them from the poverty that is outside, and there are fires all over the community, fires all over the land, and they're about to come into their neighborhood. Her father is trying to hold the community together, but she begins to lose faith in the doctrines of her early Christian formation. The city, the nation, the world is on fire. The world is collapsing around her. So she writes in her journal poetry as she tries to work out her own salvation. And she writes a poem, "All that you touch, you change. All that you change, changes you. The only lasting truth is change. God," she says, "is change." In this novel, Lauren's angst about the state of the world leads her to a kind of ambivalence about God, a kind of ambivalence about change. And I'd like to submit, if we are honest, as we see all the changes that are happening around us, we're worried about some of the changes we're seeing too. Some of those changes might have been good changes. Some of us don't know what life would have been, but can't remember what life was like before Facebook. Let the church say amen. There's some of this technology that we like in terms of being able to communicate and catch up and see things. But there are some challenges that emerge with some of these changes where I'm sure that some of us are worrying with all of this change. It seems that the more things change, the more they stay the same. The more things change, it seems like change is happening for the worse. We're living in the year of our Lord, 2024, and we have anxieties too about the state of our world right now. There's a crisis in houselessness across this city, across this nation, and across this world. There's an ongoing war in Gaza. The students are protesting, crying out against the war, and they're met with police intimidation and arrest. The Supreme Court is gutting civil rights era protections against racism and education and the voting systems, and conservatives are launching deeply funded attacks on diversity, equity, and inclusion. It seems that even as things are changing, we're not going forward in time, but we are going back. With all that is happening in our world, to paraphrase Robert Scoble, change is inevitable. And this disruption, it both brings challenge, but yet it can bring opportunity. I'd like to submit on this Pentecost Sunday that in the midst of all these changes, on this Pentecost Sunday, in the midst of all of this change, there is yet a reason to hope.
God's Spirit is not dead. Emmanuel, God is with us to change this world, not for the worse, but to change this world for the better. Because of the Holy Spirit, a change has come, and a change is gonna come. A change for salvation of our minds, salvation of our bodies, salvation of our souls, salvation of this society, dare I say, salvation of this world. But I'd like to submit yet to create and to live into this change, this divine change. We have to be open to an intervention of the Holy Spirit. See, without the Holy Spirit, we lean on our own understanding. See, but with the Holy Spirit, we are transformed by the renewal of our hearts, the renewal of our souls, the renewal of our minds. Somebody saying, Pastor, that's all well and good, but what does that have to do with Pentecost? I'm glad you asked. If we go to our scriptural text for today, Pentecost, meaning 50 weeks, it's 50 days. It's a celebration in our text of 50 days after the Passover. The Passover is the celebration of God's liberation of the Israelites from slavery in Egypt. The Jewish people would gather every year at this 50-day celebration to remind themselves what God did for their ancestors back then and what God can yet do for us right now. In our text, after Jesus' resurrection, he appears to the apostles and to prove to them that he is the resurrected Christ. He speaks with them. He teaches with them in this 50-day period. He eats with them and he reminds them, before you go out into the world, don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for what God has promised. Jesus says, John baptized with water, but don't go anywhere until you are baptized with the Holy Spirit. You see, the fact is, the disciples had walked with Jesus, they had talked with Jesus, they had learned directly from Jesus, but even after the resurrection, the disciples had a hard time still getting the message. They had walked with Jesus, they had talked with Jesus, they ate with Jesus, they had been with Jesus one-to-one all this time, but they had a problem. They still could not get the message. Well, what do you mean, preacher? Well, you see, when they returned from the Mount of Olives to Jerusalem, the disciples gathered up there in the upper room. There were 11 of the disciples remaining because Judas had already lost and taken his own life. They gathered up there in the upper room and they named every single disciple. They said there were some women there, but the Bible didn't give them names. It just said there were some women there, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, and Jesus' siblings. Eventually, up there in the upper room, there were 120 people gathered there. And the disciples got together and said, we got to find somebody who can replace Judas. And so when they got together and decided who needed to replace Judas as one of the apostles, it just so happens that when they deemed who was eligible to lead, it narrowed that 120 people down only to two people. They set qualifications for who had to lead. They said you had to be there at Jesus' baptism, and you had to be there at Jesus' crucifixion, and you had to be there at Jesus' resurrection. They said you had to have the same pedigree that we have if you want to be eligible for this position. They said you had to grow up where we grew up if you want to be eligible for this position. They said you got to have the same ethnicity that we have if you want to be eligible for this position. They said you got to be the same gender that we are if you want to be eligible for this position. They said you got to have the same education that we have if you want to be eligible for this position. They said you got to be of the same generation that we are in if you want to be eligible for this position. And since they rigged the vote so only two could qualify. Nobody knows anything about this living in this world that we're in. Somebody knows when you're applying for a scholarship and it's supposed to be for some young people of color. It's supposed to be for some black folks. It's supposed to be for some indigenous folks. And you look up and the application pool has all of a sudden increased because you got folks who say, well, I'm 1/16th Cherokee.
They rigged the game and changed the rules not to benefit those who it's really supposed to benefit. Somebody knows about trying to get some government contracts to do some real estate work in our communities and in our neighborhood. Funds that are supposed to be directed to our people so that we can invest in our own communities. But somehow they rigged the game and they changed the rules saying who's eligible, cutting our own communities out. Somebody knows something about the game getting rigged in the favor of the few when it's supposed to benefit the whole. And I'd like to submit, some of these disciples have been working in the world for so long, they said they tried to bring that mentality into the synagogue. Some of us have been working in the world so long, trying to cut other folks out. We even try to bring that kind of mentality in the church. And so when it came time for a vote, they said Justice and Matthias were the only ones who were eligible. The vote went to Matthias. They made a decision without the Holy Spirit. You see, and when we make decisions without the Holy Spirit, all that leads to is more of the same. It might be a change on the surface, it might be a change from the top, but there's no real change going on. What happens when we do the same thing, the same way, over and over again, expecting different results? What do we call that? Okay, somebody knows something. Jesus, knowing that this was the mentality of the disciples, says, I know y'all gonna try to do things your own way. Don't leave Jerusalem. But wait for what God has promised. Don't go out and do the work. Wait for what God has promised. John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And my sisters, my brothers, my siblings, and my friends, despite the vote that went down, when the Holy Spirit came in, the Holy Spirit offered an intervention. Despite the vote that went down, when the Holy Spirit came in, the Holy Spirit offered an intervention. When the Holy Spirit came, instead of 12 men doing things the same way, given the same authority to speak, God gave the whole community of believers a voice and gave the whole community of believers authority. Everybody has a contribution. We can't just keep it to a small group of people. The scripture says when the Pentecost day arrived, they were all gathered together in one place. And suddenly a sound from heaven like the howling of a fierce wind filled the entire house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be individual flames of fire alighting on each one of them. They were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them to speak. The scripture says they were pious views from every nation under heaven. Lord have mercy. From every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And when they heard this sound, when this beacon was sirened, a crowd gathered and they were mystified because everyone heard them speaking in their native languages. They were surprised and they were amazed, saying, look, aren't all the people who are speaking Galileans? These aren't all just one people. This isn't all just one race. This isn't all just one language group. Every one of them, and they understand each other. How then can each of us hear them speaking in our own language? The text says they were parked. See, I decided not to give this part to make the scripture reader read something you can't pronounce. Somebody showed me some grace, so we got to show each other some grace. Right. Said there were Parthians and Medes and Elamites, as well as residents from Mesopotamia and Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, Libya, Cyrene, residents from Rome, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the mighty works of God in our own languages. You see, all these people came from all over different places of the region. All of them knew something about getting locked out. All of them knew something about being left out. And because of what the empire in Rome had done to them, they had experienced divide and conquer. See, y'all folks stay over there and you get some crumbs from these resources. Y'all folks stay over there and you get some crumbs from these resources. Y'all folks stay over here and you don't get a vote. You just take what you get. But when the Holy Spirit intervened, God said, all of you have been pit against each other. Y'all come together by the power of the Holy Spirit. See, when the Holy Spirit comes, we aren't divided anymore. When the Holy Spirit comes, we're not strangers anymore. When the Holy Spirit comes down, we can speak to each other, and we can listen to each other, and we can understand each other, and we can all join in declaring the mighty works of God. This is the birthday of the church, when all people come together and we stand together and we listen to one another and we all join hands wherever we come from, singing of the works of God. That is the birth of the church. That's the birth of Holman Church. If you don't know the birth of Holman Church on this Pentecost Sunday, well, let's do a little history lesson on the birth of Holman Church. Every time I have an opportunity to go to the church office, I love walking by that commendation from the state of California from 1996. Probably need to put that in a more public area so everybody can read it. But there was a commendation from the state of California in 1996 celebrating Holman for its invaluable contributions to the lives of the people of Los Angeles and the entire state of California. Reminding us of our humble beginnings as a small group of seven people worshiping at a Seventh-day Adventist sanctuary to eventually having over 100 ministries in service to the community. And whenever I read that resolution, I always get to that clause where it says, whereas, as a Black American congregation, I mean, we got people from Alabama and Louisiana. As a Black American congregation, Holman's membership has roots in Panama, it has roots in Ghana, it has roots in Belize, it has roots in Jamaica, it has roots in Nigeria, it has roots in Liberia, it has roots in St. Thomas, it has roots in Sierra Leone, it has roots in Brazil, it has roots in Korea, it has roots all over this world. See, the birth of this congregation is the people coming, all of us speaking in our dialects, all of us speaking in our languages, all of us bringing all of our cultures to the table, and the Holy Spirit doing a work in us that we can make a difference in this world. A change is gonna come. That's the story of the birth of the church. And so when it was up to the disciples in this passage by themselves, they forgot their story. And they said, well, the more things change, they have to say the same. But when the Holy Spirit steps in, God initiates a change for the better. And see, when the Holy Spirit initiates that change, there are going to be people saying, what are y'all doing? When the Holy Spirit initiates that change, there are people going to say, you're out of order. That's not the way things are supposed to work. That's not the way we are supposed to make decisions. That's not the way, the approach that we are supposed to take. How is it that all these people from all these places can come together and understand each other? They must have had some new wine. They must be out their mind. But then Peter finally understands. Peter, the scripture says, starting at verse 14, Peter stood with the other 11 apostles. He raised his voice and he declared, Judeans and everyone living in Jerusalem, know this, listen carefully to my words. These people aren't drunk, as you suspect. After all, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. They had time yet. Rather, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. Chapter 2, 28 through 32, in the last days, God says, I will pour my spirit on all people. In the last days, your sons and your daughters will prophesy. In the last days, your young will see visions and your elders will dream dreams. You see, in the last days, everybody has a contribution to make. Everybody has a voice. Everybody has authority for the direction of the church and for this world. The teenagers and those who are the sages, everybody has something to offer. With an intervention of the Holy Spirit, the young will see what we can't see and cast a vision for a new way of being together. And with an intervention of the Holy Spirit, the elders will dream dreams. Dreams not just for us, but dreams for our children and our children's children. See, the reality, you see, the world has been so hostile to us, some of us are scared to have visions anymore.
The world has been so hostile to us, some of us are scared to have dreams anymore. The world has been so hostile to us, it leads us to hate our neighbors, to resent our children, to despise our elders, even to hate ourselves. But when the intervention of the Holy Spirit comes, we learn how to love our neighbor. When the intervention of the Holy Spirit comes, we learn how to listen to our children. When the Holy Spirit comes in that intervention, we revere our elders. When the Holy Spirit comes and the intervention comes, we love our neighbors as ourselves. Some of us can't love our neighbors because we don't know how to love ourselves. But when the intervention of the Holy Spirit comes, we can love ourselves, we can love our neighbors, we can love all people with the love of God in Christ Jesus. See, I'm so thankful for the Holy Spirit. In a world that wants us to give up, in a world that pushes us to give out, the Holy Spirit intervenes and says, a change is gonna come. I'm so glad that our ancestors didn't give up and give out. I'm so glad that in the midst of the crucible of enslavement and colonization, our ancestors were praying for us. I'm so glad that in the midst of what they faced, they never lost sight of vision. They never lost sight of the dream. Somebody said, I'm living on the prayers of my grandmama. I'm living on the prayers of my grandfather. I'm living on the prayers of my great, 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 great grand. Somebody prayed for me and had me on their mind, and they took the time and prayed for me. I'm living on the prayers of my great grandmama right now. Somebody needs to know that that prayer was an intervention of the Holy Spirit giving conviction that a change is going to come, and that's a change that only the Holy Spirit could bring. So much so that the scripture says, even upon my servants, and other translations read slaves, even upon them I will pour my spirit out in those days, and they will prophesy. With an intervention of the Holy Spirit, we are slaves no more. No one is a second-class citizen. No one is unworthy of decency. No one is unworthy of respect. No one is unworthy of dignity. But God pours out God's Spirit that all will prophesy. That's the change that the Holy Spirit brings, a divine change that's gonna come. I'm going a little long, but I'm gonna work with this illustration right here. Since we had a strategic, organized effort, Pastor Washington, to help make sure our young folks were here today and leading and serving. So thank you for leading, right? Thank you for leading. All right. But we know in our heritage about an intervention of the Holy Spirit that brings everybody to the table. We know in our heritage about an intervention of the Holy Spirit when we wouldn't let other persons get a word out their mouth, the Holy Spirit says everybody has a voice. When we've been trying to bend the world to our favor, the Holy Spirit intervenes that we may be formed in God's favor. And the world will look at us and say, this doesn't make sense. They'll say we're under the influence of something. And we'll say we're under the influence of the intervention of the Holy Spirit. Say, listen carefully to my words. All these people speaking in different languages, yet understanding one another. I'd like to submit, there are a lot of different languages. Yes, there are spoken languages, Xhosa, English, Kiswahili, Arabic, Spanish, Latin, Hebrew, German, Portuguese. We speak all these languages. Dare I say, culturally, hip-hop is a language, too. Everybody can't speak that language. Some of us dare not speak that language. There are a few 3, 4, 5, and 6-letter words that we say shouldn't even be in our vocabulary. So we say we shouldn't speak that language. But I'm reminded of a story that just happened recently. I wasn't there, but I heard this story from Reverend Nima. She was out at the mall, over at the Fox Hills Mall. See, if you're from Los Angeles, it's not Westfield, but it's... You know, it's Fox Hill. That's the language. That's the language, right? So Reverend Nima was at the mall with her mother and with our daughter. Again, who's 12 years old. And they went to go get something to drink at their favorite boba spot there. At Fox Hills Mall, and there was a tip jar. On the tip jar, there were pictures of two different tip jars and a picture of two individuals. And one tip jar had a picture of a hip-hop recording artist by the name of Drake. And there was another that had, the other jar had a picture of a hip-hop artist who goes by the name of Kendrick Lamar. So they invited customers to place tips in the jar with which artist is winning in the hip-hop beef between Drake and Kendrick Lamar. And so Grandma Cyrus says, well, what's going on? I don't understand what they are talking about. What is this beef between Drake and Kendrick Lamar? And Grandma said, well, you know, I like Drake because Drake had a song called God's Plan. She said, I like Drake because Drake had a song where he said, I started from the bottom, now I'm here. So I started from the bottom so I could resonate with Drake. But our daughter tried to give her some advice and say, you may want to hesitate from trying to side with Drake, especially in the Los Angeles, California. You may want to hesitate from siding with Drake. Because though Drake sang about that, Drake long time ago said, Nazareth, I'm messed up and you're messed up, but if God got us, then we gonna be all right. And so he said, you know, so you may want to hesitate from siding with Drake. You might want to side with Kendrick Lamar. And then as I talked to my daughter about it, she said so many people at her school are going from Kendrick Lamar, so much so that now the kids that came to school ready to fight, she said they stopped fighting for 2 weeks because everybody was siding with Kendrick over Drake. Kendrick Lamar's music was bringing people together, and he ended up winning this rap war between these two artists with a song that goes by the title Not Like Us. Somebody, y'all know this song, right? Some of us, you need to learn some, know about the song, Not Like Us. Not Like Us, it became a bop. It became a unifying anthem for people all over Los Angeles and all over the world. Yes, though Kendrick uses some language that some of us are unfamiliar with, if we learn how to listen with the Holy Spirit, we learn that he gives some language that is unifying language to address the change that we need to come in this world. I try to tell my daughter, you have classmates who come to school ready to fight. They're mimicking at school the same violence they're experiencing at home. The folks at home are mimicking the same violence that they've experienced out in this world. They're only following what they has been presented before them. But if we can help them understand that they are beloved children of God, they can discover that they don't have to live in an attitude of violence, but we can live in an attitude of hope and of love for all God's children. And so Kendrick gives some language in this music that gives some language for some young folk who've experienced sexual violence so they can call out that violence. Kendrick is saying, I hear you. Kendrick gives some language for some young people to call out hypocrisy that we're seeing in this world. When he says it, I'm with you and I hear you. He even gives some language to challenge stereotypes about us, especially when we don't want to acknowledge the vestiges of enslavement that are still present in our society and in our world. See, Drake said in one rhyme, Kendrick tries to rap like he's trying to free the slaves. So Kendrick said, well, once upon a time, all of us was in chains. And then Drake still doubled down calling us some slaves. And then he tells a story of Atlanta, Georgia. He says, Atlanta was the Mecca building railroads and trains. And bear with me for a second. Let me put y'all on some game. You see, the settlers were using the townsfolk to make themselves richer. And then fast forward to 2024, and they have the same agenda. And Kendra says, Drake, you acting just like the folks that came and took advantage of our labor for their own benefit and not the benefit of all God's people. You're acting like the same people who come into our neighborhoods and steal what we have to benefit the few and not benefit the whole. So he says, you run to Atlanta when you need a few dollars. You're not a colleague, you're just a colonizer. He says, because, see, they're not like us. They're not like us. They're not like us. You see, they think manipulation, exploitation, and greed will have the last word. But we know that those who get left out, God brings everybody in. They are not like us.
With the Holy Spirit, we believe that God always brings the rest of the community in. They tried to decide by themselves who had the authority to preach. They tried to decide by themselves who had the authority to teach. They tried to decide by themselves who had the authority to serve and lead, but they are not like us. With the Holy Spirit, we believe in the priesthood of all believers. Every voice matters. You see, they say we can't come together as black folks. They say we can't come together as indigenous folks. They say we can't come together as white folks and Asian folks and queer folks and straight folks and rich folks and poor folks and immigrant folks and citizen folks and undocumented folks and upper class folks and working class folks, the GI generation, the silent generation, the baby boomer generation, generation X, Y, and Z. They say we can't communicate with each other. They say we can't learn from each other. They say we'll never be able to understand each other. They say what God can't do, but we say what God can do. They're not like us because we've received the intervention of the Holy Spirit. So my sisters, my brothers, my siblings, my friends, the Holy Spirit on this Pentecost Sunday says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young will see visions. Your elders will dream dreams. On this Pentecost Sunday, the scripture says, we're not slaves anymore. We're not slaves to our selfishness, slaves to greed, slaves to control others, slaves of resentment, slaves to the powers and principalities of this world that seek to lock us away, lock us down, and lock us out. But God says, I'll pour out my spirit and all will prophesy. A change is going to come. Let us be open to an intervention of the Holy Spirit, that God's divine change shall continue to manifest in our lives, not just for our generation, but for generations and generations to come. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. I'm not going anywhere near that chancel again. It's kind of hot up there. Sweet chin music. I'm not giving up the ox. Octavia Butler and K-Dot in the same sermon. Oh, my God. Y'all show some love for Victor Silas. Thank you. Really. Reverend Victor Cyrus-Franklin. In response to that sermon, we offer three invitations. You might be saying right now, I want to join that church. And if you do, it's very, very simple to join. There is now a card in the pews that you can actually pull out and just put your information on and say, I want to become a member. Drop that off on your way out, and we will be in touch with you directly. In the same way, you can actually use this card also if you need to speak to a pastor. You might be saying, there's some change that needs to happen in my life. I feel change coming, or there's change that needs to come that I need to be part of, but I want to talk to a pastor. I want to see how I can get involved. Or maybe you just need someone who can counsel with you. If that's you, then you can put there that you want to meet the pastor. Finally, you might need prayer and feel like this is a moment in time for you that says that you want to connect with this Holy Spirit that is freely given to all. That maybe before today you'd even feel worthy of receiving that kind of gift or being that empowered. But today you feel and know that that Spirit, that gift is for everyone. That intervention is for all of us. Use this card as well to ask for prayer. Let me pray for you as we close this sermonic moment.
God, for those who are making decisions now in this Kairos moment that is fueled by your Spirit, we pray that you bring clarity, sound mind and thinking, so that they might overcome fear and make the next divine move forward, whether to be a member of our congregation, whether to get some counseling and get some help, whether it is to also to offer themselves to say, I'm here to serve now. God, in all those ways, we pray that your Holy Spirit would anoint us, anoint all those who are giving, all of us who are receiving their gifts, so that we might see you glorified in this place and in this community. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen.
Open the altar for those who may want to come in prayer. As Pastor Khristian always says, if you are in need of prayer and would like someone to join with you, we invite you to just come with your hands open. And if not, and your head is just bowed, we will allow you to be. But the altar is open, and we receive this word in song.
Everyone who loves
wipe their tears away. Just pray, my love, and I'll be there right away.
This isn't on the bulletin, but I just have to move in the spirit at this moment. Is that okay? I would like to ask if Pastor Victor and Pastor Khristian would come forward, and all of our youth and young adults that are in the sanctuary right now would just come forward for a moment of prayer. All of our youth and young adults, don't make me point y'all out, but our youth and our young people were key to putting this service together today. Amen. They helped choose the songs. This was about being sure that we had a time and a moment that resonated not only with all of you, but with them. And welcome them into this space. Pastor Victor spoke today about a change. And the change that I am just so happy to see is each and every one of them. I know they get probably are bothered that I still call them my babies, but they are. You're a little older now. And I guess I can't throw things across the room at you in the hype room. But I'm just so touched and honored to have each and every one of them. We see our future in front of us this morning. And Pastor Victor spoke about, right, what we're seeing in our society and the battles and this song. And I just would love to have you all pray over our youth and our young adults, that they might remember that God is and will always be all that they need. He is just a prayer away. Hallelujah.
As we pray, if you're joining us on YouTube, if you can reach out your hand in community with us, if we're in the house, if we're in the sanctuary, we can reach out our hand as we pray over these young people. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we love you and we thank you today. We thank you for the reminder that in you, in Christ Jesus, there is no slave, no Greek, slave or free, Jew or Greek, but we are all one in Christ Jesus. And we thank you, O Lord, for every generation represented in this room, every generation represented in this space and worship, and just pray for this generation and these generations that are before us right now. They have come into a world that is not of their own creation. They're responding to challenges that many of us could never foresee and have difficulty understanding. And so many of us don't know how we can be of help and support. But one thing we do know is we may not have the answers, but we know who does. We may not have the solutions, but we know who has all power in their hands. Jesus, we just ask for you to touch the lives of each and every one of these young people, reminding them that they are not alone, but what a friend they have in Jesus. All their griefs to bear, what a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Remind these young people that they are not alone, but in community with one another, and in community in your church. They are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, and they're surrounded by a church community that is encouraging them and rooting for them, and we have a listening ear when they need somebody to talk to, and we have a source of encouragement and hope when they need some encouragement or hope. They don't walk this journey alone, but we walk this journey together. Remind these generations of young people, Lord, that they stand on the shoulders of their ancestors, and that we come from a mighty people. With all that our ancestors have endured, with all the strength that our ancestors had mustered, they passed that on to us, and they passed that on to you. Help these young people to continue to walk with their chins high. Help them to walk with their back straight. Remind them that they are children of the Almighty God, and no weapon formed against them shall prosper. Give them the power to lead. We need them to lead, oh Lord, not in the future. We need them to lead right now. Give them the power and the wisdom and the courage to cast vision. Vision that we can't see, but vision that God has gifted them to see. Give them the courage to live in the gifts that you had placed in them for the benefit of their families, the benefit of our communities, for the benefit of this nation, for the benefit of this world, that a change will come through them. A change where we can put down our sword and shield and study war no more. A change where all can come and experience the bounty of the blessing of God. A change where all can know that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and that all are gifts of the Almighty God. Pour out your Holy Spirit on them and us, that we can be who you have called and created us to be. This we pray. We pray with hope. We pray with courage. We pray with love. We pray with thanksgiving. In Jesus' holy name, and the people of God said amen, amen, and amen. If you would, thank y'all. As y'all return to your seats, give each other a hug and say thank you for being the gift of you are. Give each other a hug, right? All right. And as they return to their seats, if you got a young person coming to you, give them a hug and say just thank you for the gift that you are. Amen.
Good morning, Holman Church. I'm Nancy Harris, and I'm coming to bring you some updates this morning. As many of you know, we are in the middle of Foster Care Awareness Month, and my heart just this morning is just pitter-patter. It's just so wonderful seeing all of you and all of you all, and young people that I've known since they were little, well, not that little, but little. And just to see them in their full glory and smiles and love and the love of God, it really got my heart pitter-pattering here. So on that note, I am coming to bring you some updates as it relates to Foster Care Awareness Month. And I want to start off with Deuteronomy 10, verse 18. He defends the course of the fatherless and the widow and loves the alien, giving him food and clothing. Pastor Khristian and I had a conversation this week, and he asked me why I do this work. And, you know, I never really thought about it in terms of really forming full sentences about why I do this work. But this morning, thank you, Pastor Victor, because it is the Holy Spirit that has driven me to do this work. The Holy Spirit told me that, Nancy, you are blessed, and you have to be a blessing to others. That is why I do this work. Thank you. That is why I do this work. There are many out there. We have no idea of the people out there that may be sitting amongst us. Young people, to no fault of their own, have become down, spirits down, spirits broken, families broken, and we as the church need to wrap around them. And I praise and congratulate all of you who have stepped up to answer the call, the small call to bring grocery carts. Because again, in this verse, he talks about making sure we bring food and clothing. That is part of what we do. The other part of what we need to do is wrap around our vulnerable families, wrap around our children. They're not just foster kids. They didn't ask to be that. Who in here is gonna say, I wanna be broken, torn away from my family and put in another family, hopefully? No one asked for that. So we have to step up and stand in the gap and make sure that we wrap around our children and families to provide the most that we can and stabilize their lives and make sure that they are happy, happy people. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So this past week, the 3FN, the Faith Foster Families Network, that I have the privilege of leading, we hosted an event that brought together pastors and churches all across South LA. And 13 of those churches and pastors stepped up and said they wanted to do something and be provided assistance in being a part of a young person's life and bringing their church around how we can help broken families re-heal and, I think that's a word, or heal and become whole again. 13 churches. These are 13 different churches. Again, it's not about denomination. It's about love. It's about the Holy Spirit, and it's about uplifting and strengthening humanity. So that was one. Yesterday, I was out at Zoe Christian Fellowship in Whittier. There was a conference that was focused on young people as they transition out of the foster care system. So that's young people between the ages of 18 and 26. And it was all about coming together and collaborating as Christians to make sure those young people have what they need. You know, the percentage of homelessness is high in that population. There's over 900 people that'll be, 900 young people graduating high school this year that will be coming out of the foster care system. Many of them do not know where they're going to be sleeping tomorrow. High degree of homelessness, high degree of food insecurity. And I just want to use that and pivot and say thank you, Holman Church, for stepping up and answering the call to bring grocery cards that we, in turn, we're going to share with the Children, Youth, and Family Collaborative, CYFC, so that we can spread and do our part in helping a young person as they deal with trying to find their way in this world. So thank you for that. Thank you. Give yourselves a hand. And if you didn't bring your grocery card today, that's okay. You can bring it next week. You can bring it during the week. We're here, as the comedians say, we're open all night, or we're here all day, we're here all weekend, so no problem with that. So thank you. Thank you again, Holman Church, for stepping up, as you always do. I also want to share that in the education building, we are going to be taking some space there. As I mentioned a couple weeks ago, we've got a beautiful space that we're going to be designing that is going to be for families as they attempt to reunify, family bonding space. There'll be a space where we'll have resources for our families and young people. And so I just, again, want to thank the Holman Church for stepping up and providing that opportunity. And then lastly, I just want to say, continue to pray. Continue to pray. There's a lot that goes on out there that we may not really be aware of and be cognizant of. There's a lot of despair, a lot of danger. There's a lot of, we hear Pastor Khristian tell his wonderful story about his experience, but how he experienced some mental challenges and hurdles that he had to overcome based upon being separated from his biological family. It has much more of an impact than you all may actually realize. So think about that. And think about our next step, and that's really wrapping around humans, wrapping around our young people, and wrapping around our families face to face, not just from afar, but face to face. So I thank you once again, home and family, for your support and your love. And let's keep on moving on. And thank you, Pastor Victor, for that inspiring word. Young people, we love you. I always tease myself and say I'm a millennial. Now I'm even going to go down a generation. I'm a millennial trapped in a baby boomer body. So I just want to say I love you all and looking forward to being a part of your success. Thank you very much.
During this moment in our service, when we receive offerings, I invite you all to consider all the ways of giving. You might drop off your envelope as you leave the sanctuary, make a secure donation online with Givelify or Vanco. You may scan the QR code on the back of your worship bulletin or send a check to the address listed on the front of your bulletin. Please take advantage of the radio broadcast sponsorship discount to share the message with those who are sick, shut in, or far away. Or you can adorn the altar with flowers to celebrate an occasion or honor a loved one. To order flowers or sponsor a radio broadcast, visit the Holman website or contact Holman at holmanumc.com. There are many avenues of giving. Prayerfully consider them and let your heart lead you to the offering that best honors your relationship with God. We thank you for your continued generosity in support of the mission and vision of the Holman United Methodist Church.
In the spirit of giving and to support Foster Care Awareness Month, Holman's Youth and Young Adult Ministry is donating $200 worth of grocery store gift cards to support those exiting foster care. I'd also like to turn your attention to the announcements in your bulletin. We're so glad that you're here. Join us for fellowship after service in LL White Hall. 3FN will have an exhibit where you can visit with Ms. Harris and learn more about supporting young adults exiting foster care while enjoying good company, light refreshments, and inspiring music provided by Christian mixer DJ Count. Children ages 5 to 12 years old are welcome in both Whitehall and the chapel, where there will be face painting from 9:30 to 10:30 a.m. Discover Significance Boot Camp, turning vision into a plan, continues this Wednesday, May 22nd. Come to LL Whitehall for refreshments at 6:30 p.m. Stay for Bible study and strategic planning at 7. Discover Significance Boot Camp is a transformative Christian workshop where participants engage in journey of self-discovery and growth, guided by faith and empathy. Pick up a flyer in the rear of the sanctuary and register today. Join the Association of Black Social Workers at Crenshaw Yoga and Dance for a generational wellness carnival today, Sunday, May 19th. The carnival runs until 6 p.m. There's time to attend worship service before heading to Crenshaw Yoga and Dance. Our own Reverend Khristian Washington will speak at 2 p.m. You can find registration details on the back of the worship bulletin.
Thank you. So we are so grateful for the intervention of the Holy Spirit today. My shirt, if you guys didn't see it, it says, Jesus changes everything. Okay? Well, I guess now we'll say with the onset of the Holy Spirit, that changes everything. and it initiates a change unlike any other, and we are so grateful. As we close, our youth and young adults just want to again extend an invitation for all of you to please not just run out the door, but join us in the White Hall for a time of continued worship with all of our hairstyles, languages, right, and even ways of giving praise, but definitely all in the same spirit and all in the same vein. So we are excited and we thank you for your continued support, and we look forward to seeing you there.
Please connect with us as we gather for dynamic worship, grow through inspired learning, and go into joyful service to live the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you for your continued partnership in ministry. God bless you. Now, Pastor Washington will give the benediction.
Send us forth from this place, O God, a changed people. Send us forth from this place, having accepted the intervention of the Holy Spirit in our lives so that we can hear one another, so that we can share with one another, that we can honor that all people are gifted to serve, gifted to lead, gifted with a voice, that our sons and our daughters, our children shall prophesy, and that all of our elders will dream dreams. Send us forth from this place with faith, hope, courage, and love. And as we do, we'll give you all praise, all honor, and all glory, for they belong to you and you alone. This we pray in Christ's holy name. And the people of God said, amen, amen, amen and amen. We'll be right back.